Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the National Library of Australia. My name is Emma Jolly, and I'm a senior advisor in the Library's Collection Branch. To begin, I would like to acknowledge Australia's First Nations peoples as the traditional owners and custodians of this land, and pay my respects to the elders, past and present, and through them to all Australian Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples. Thank you so much for attending this event, which is coming to you from Ngambri, from Ngunnawal and Ngambri country. Okay, so the reason we're here this afternoon is a presentation, Chinese Diaspora in Cold War Australia by Dr Mei-fen Kuo, a 2023 National Library of Australia Fellow. Our distinguished fellowship program supports researchers to make intensive use of the National Library's rich collection through residencies of 12 weeks. These fellowships are made possible by generous philanthropic support, and Mei-fen's fellowship has been generously supported by the Stokes family. Dr Mei-fen Kuo is a lecturer in contemporary Chinese culture and history at Macquarie University. Over the past decade, she has dedicated her research efforts to the field of Chinese diaspora history in Australia. She is the author of Making Chinese Australia, Urban Elites, Newspapers, and Chinese Australian Identity During Federation, and Unlocking the History of Australasian Kuomintang. Her research has often been supported by the Australian Research Council, the Australian Academy of the Humanities, Taiwan Fellowship, and Taiwan Foundation for Democracy. In her presentation today, Mei-fen will present research findings on the narrative surrounding Chinese-Australian relations during the Cold War, portraying the Chinese diaspora as active authors of their own stories. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Mei-fen Kuo.
Thank you, Emma, for your kind introduction, and thank you everyone for coming. I also like to begin to acknowledge the traditional owner of the land we are meeting today. I thank the elders past and present for taking care of this land we are privileged to call home today. I also want to acknowledge any other First Nation people attending today or watching me online. This fellowship has been an amazing experience for me. The librarians are so excellent to help me, and I think Sharon and Simone from the fellowship team deserve a special mention. They have helped keep me on track and connect me with other fellows. Thank you so much. And also many thanks to the Stokes family for their generous donation. Their support has been very valuable to me and many others. I also would like to take this opportunity to thank many people who give me the permission to access their personal and family collection, as well as their oral history interviews. Thank you for sharing your stories, which had been so inspiring for my research. This presentation is part of my broader project on Chinese diaspora in Cold War Australia. When we often hear the term Cold War through around in media and political discourse, its significance lies in understanding its impact on people's life and experience. Therefore, my fellowship aims to document the Chinese experience in Australia during the Cold War period. At the core of my approach is the recognition that the Cold War was not solely about the great power struggle, but also encompassed social politics in everyday life. Within this context, Chinese cafe image is an important sign of the exploitation. This cafe represents more than just a place to enjoy delicious Chinese food. They embody the dynamic of a power struggle, business in innovation, and critically, the formation of a Chinese working culture within the context of Cold War Australia. I will talk about this very soon. Specifically, today's presentation will particularly focus on 1950. I will explain why this particular very key period to understand Chinese diaspora in Australia during the Cold War period. So in today's presentation, I will begin by discussing the significance of the 1950 period, drawing up the insight from the National Libraries of Australia's collection and recent scholarship. Within this context, I aim to explore the constitution in the dynamic between the Chinese cafe employer and the workers. This explanation will lead us to question the underlying the reason behind the division with the Chinese community during this period. I will also explore into a case study that showcases the collaboration between Chinese and Australian workers. Through this case study, we will uncover the significance of their collective activities and the powerful implication it holds for the understanding the broader social dynamic of the Cold Australia. So to begin my presentation, I want to particularly focus, I want to talk about the image I show in my slide. And this photo I show here is collected by Bruce Liu, a shop owner in Melbourne Chinatown and a permanent member of the Melbourne Kuomintang Society, which is known as the Chinese National Party. This photo marks a significant historical event for the Chinese diaspora in Cold War Australia. The photo was taken in Melbourne Chinatown, Little Burger Street, where there are many Chinese shops, cafes, and restaurants. The dragon was put up to welcome the Olympic team from Republic of China, Taiwan, in Melbourne in 1956. I changed the slide. This is a border image you can see. And if you look closer, you will see there is a national flag of the Republic of China, as known as the Taiwan today. And the present of the national flag of Republic of China in the photo serves as a powerful symbol of the support for free China and opposition to communism at the time. Documents from the National Library of Australia, such as the papers of Sir W.S. Ken Hughes, tell us more about the context surrounding this mobilization. Ken Hughes, who serves as the chairman of the organizing committee for the Olympic Games in 1956, was known to be a devout supporter against communism. And he's showing support for Free China's team in his arrangement in 1956, in which he upset Communist China. So team from Communist China decided not to join the Olympic in 1956. This photo serves as a visual representation of the geopolitical tension in local context during the Cold War era. And I also want to use this photo to explain understanding the Cold War require an examination of the both power dynamic and the representation. And one of the challenges on doing research on the Cold War history is the challenge to access to the document. So I want to highlight the photo was stayed in Bruce's house for very long after the Australian recognition of the People's Republic of China in 1972. And then his society, the Chinese National Party in Australia, closed its door to the public, stored their historical document away. And then it was until the National Library's community grant about more than 10 years ago, get an opportunity for us, like the researchers like us, to lock the door and say, it's time, we would like to examine this document. So I want to also show this. The National Library's community heritage grant played a very key role to unlock the Cold War document. And also I'm very delighted that the Melbourne Kuomintang Society, they had decided to donate their historical document to the National Library. So thereby, I believe in the future, they will make the source more available for future research on Chinese-Australian history. So in today's discussion, one challenge for me when I begin to do this research is how we can access to the document during the Cold War, and particularly I really want to dig the voice, the story, the experience of the Chinese back to that time. And luckily, today there is a growing interest in both family history and public history. This interest has led to more available documents which help us to consider how society has changed over time from middle or below. Through this document, we can see how families and community had played a significant role in shaping Australia's life of way, and also Australian society, how they viewed Asia and its culture, especially during the important policy shift, like the change in Asia immigration. Many historians today already point out the 1950s as the crucial time for understanding this change. So 1950s, this period marked a fascinating period in Australia's history. Following the upheaving of the World War II, Australia experienced a significant economic and social recovery. This area saw a surge in migration from Europe, as many saw new opportunity in the relatively stable ultra economy, and additionally, Asia began to image as an increasing attractive region for Australians, not only for travel, but also for business. This shift reflects a broader trend of Australia's growing engagement with the Asia-Pacific region during this time, laying the groundwork for future economy and cultural ties. National Library's collection provided insight into the impact of the so-called people-to-people connection between Australia, mainland China, and Taiwan in the 1950s. So these two images here just show just the example. And one example here, the writing of Frank Curran, a very famous Australian writer, about Taiwan, provided Australia with a window into non-communist country, raising the understanding and paving the way for Australia to become one of Taiwan's top tourism destinations a decade later. Furthermore, institutions like the universities, international house, and the NGO play the other significant role in engaging Asian students, shaping the public opinion and contribute to the debate and the individual dismantling of the larger policy, that's argued by Australian historian. So this is examples highlight the multi-faced way in which interpersonal connection and cultural exchange had shaped Australia's relationship with Asia and its changed immigration policy. Then the question is, what role did the Chinese community play during this period? Did they have a similar influence to other groups? During the 1950s, there was a growing increase of the establishment of the local Chinese association. For example, students' organization. As a number of Chinese students studying in Australia, they play a role in forming a student organization, providing a platform for engagement with other students. A standout example is the Chinese Student Club in Victoria, which took measures such as publishing a bilingual magazine to enhance the participation in social activity among students. I'm very lucky the National Library owned one copy of this magazine, and which is now is available. We can view online at the National Library's website. And the other association I want to highlight is Women's Association. And this association is was rooted from a very famous Sydney Dragon Ball, which began from the late 1930s. And first one, who is in the center of this photo, first, one of the key organizers of this event during the area shared her insight in an interview achieved. So her interview was also in-house in National Library. So she arrived during the wartime in Sydney with her diplomat husband and played a significant role in founding the Chinese Women Association in 1954. Initially, the association, so according to her interview, the association, the Chinese Women Association, was formed with the aim of the opposition communism, as suggested by Madam Chiang Kai-shek in Taiwan. However, the Chinese Women Association is primarily focused on social and tribal activity. Phase Wong's interview, along with lots of other Chinese Australian individuals, is achieved in the National Library Oral History Interview Collection, offering a very good source to explore the diverse perspective within the Cold War area of Australia. We have a very respective community leader, William Liu's oral history interview in National Library. So he was interviewed in 1978, which was a very early oral history collection for the National Library. And moreover, the National Library has a great interview with the very important figure from the community, such as Arthur Gallo Jen in Sydney and Morris Leung in Melbourne. Both individuals were highly active and respect members of the community, providing further insight into experiences and the contribution of the trans-Australian during this period. And many others primarily focus on their family and community life. I really suggest if you want to learn more about the Chinese-Australian stories during this period, this oral history project. Now we have the four oral history projects. They would be a very good source to dip on. So when this interview are available, I find also it's very important. So some interview will be available online, so you can just listen online, and then it will come to this statement from the National Library to remind us that this interview service as individual's point of view may not catch the full scope of the event. And I find this statement is quite interesting, also quite important. And additionally, this interview highlights the notion that the identity are socially constructed, shaped by the personal experience, social inference, and the historical context. So even they talk about one topic, you will hear from a different perspective, you know, from their background. The theory is very, very different thing, and the opinion is all very different. For example, we take a trans cafe as an example. Different historical interviews provide very different insights. For example, Mei Yang, in her 1993 interview, tell us she like, you know, she recall the time of the Chinatown is, you know, when everyone know each knew each other, and then you know which cafe to go, and that's because you know your circle, the cafe will identify your social circle. On the other hand, Margaret Young Kelly returned to Sydney in the 1950s and found Chinatown a little bit quiet, a little bit bored, and with a cuisine that failed to meet her expectation in terms of the taste and quality. And the other case is Severin Liu, and she was interviewed just recently, and very interesting, the family migrated from mainland China to Taiwan, and then when she was a teenager, she wanted to escape from Taiwan's academic pressure. So he decided to come to Sydney to study. However, she recalls her missed experience studying and working at her auntie's Chinese cafe or Chinese restaurant. So she provides a very different point of view about a Chinese cafe. And most important, I want to highlight here is the interview of the professor Cam Lui. And he growing up in Chinatown, witnessed the challenge faced by workers and market gardeners. He recalled his family necessary to make the spin roll for sale to shop and restaurant. Professor Lewis' insights have been particularly enlightening, promoting a deeper exploration of the experience of the workers during the Cold War period, especially those from Chinese background and their life realities, struggle, and achievement. I expect so much from his interview. And then the other very important document I find at the library influenced me to pay more attention on worker is a publication by Xie Tang in Mandarin, and titled Lu Zhu Ao Zhou Si Shi Nian, that is his memoir of resident in Australia for 40 years. This book was published in 1983 in Hong Kong, and so far I didn't see a lot of discussion on this book. This book is only 120 pages, but it's incredible book, and is talking about his diverse working experience in Sydney. He recounts his time as a seaman on a steamship. So Xie Tang come to Sydney as a seaman in 1941, and then changed different works. And he worked in a factory as a market gardener, as a worker in different cafes, and before eventually opened his own Chinese restaurant in Sydney in 1955. Xie Tang's account provided valuable insights into the often overlooked experience of a Chinese worker in Australia. I also inspired so much from his book. He recounts forming close friendship with fellow workers, particularly the non-Chinese workers, such as the Henry Petty. He was from New Zealand. And interesting from Xie Tang's memoir, Henry decided to give financial support to Xie Tang and allow him to open his own restaurant in 1955. And this memoir serves as a moving reminder of the pathway and the value of the Chinese workers and the politics within the cafe. And Xie Tang have a detail talk about the policy inside the cafe, the competition, and also distrust, and also different business strategy among the different people inside the cafe, underscoring the significance of the further explanation and understanding of this dynamic. And most importantly, Xie Tang was among of the about 900 Chinese wartime arrivals who settled in Sydney during the World War II, with many of them being seamen. This period was crucial for Australians to become familiar with the Asian or Chinese cuisine, especially those who had served in Asia or the South Pacific Island. A considerable number of these Chinese war arrivals become deeply involved in Sydney's cafe, contributing as a customer's employee or even owner, thereby leaving a lasting impact on the culinary landscape and the cultural dynamic of the city. So beginning, I talk about the dynamic inside the cafe. I also want to briefly talk about the history of the Chinese cafe. And when I talk about Chinese cafe, which is different compared with the Chinese restaurant we know today. So normally, the Chinese cafe is different from the Chinese cooking house of the early 20th century. So Chinese cafe, they will serve both Chinese and English, all the European cuisine. And the purpose is because they also want to attract the Austria customers. So in Melbourne, we have the Canton Cafe, open early than Sydney's Shanghai Cafe. Shanghai Cafe in Sydney opened in 1917 and located at the High Market, where a growing number of the Chinese were involved in the fruit and vegetable market. And High Market is also the area we call Chinatown. And then we have the second Chinese cafe, Peking Cafe, which opened in 1919, just at the end of the World War I. Move away from Haymarket, move away from Chinatown. Both Chinese cafe in Sydney were managed by Sydney Chinese nationalists. I'm going to talk about a little bit about Peking Cafe because this cafe has a very significant meaning. So Peking Cafe was influenced by Sydney's Chinese Nationalist Party and also influenced by Chinese American restaurant and operate as a blend of the Zhaotrey House, an English restaurant, and a ballroom. So Peking Cafe, that is a three-story house. So first floor, that was Zhaotrey House, so-called Chinese, provide Chinese food. Second floor is English restaurant. You can have the English tea room. And then third floor is a ballroom. You have the social dancing. So Zhaotrey, that is a particular dish during the interwar period, meaning meat leftover. It's widely credited to Chinese American in the 1980s and become very popular in the United States from 1900 to 1960. And then the Melbourne's Canton Cafe, the first introduced Zhaotrey to the urban resident in Australia in early 20th century. And then Chinese nationalists in Sydney, they say, hey, we are going to portray this dish as an international dish. Because they find the Zhaotrey is so interesting, it meets, you know, left over, just like a Chinese diaspora. You know, they went through a different experience, they mix with different cultural values and tastes to reshape their identity in your society. And also very important is the Peking Cafe played a significant role in hosting a large dinner for the Chinese nationalists in the 1920s from across the Australia, New Zealand, and South Pacific Island. And also this event marked a historical occasion as it was the first time Australian politicians accepted invitation of such gathering. And also, I also have the example here. You can see Peking Cafe also attract the customers because of it have the jazz dancing. Peking Cafe also play a pioneer role by successfully lobby for an explanation for special needs staff. Previously, the significance of the Chinese cafe or all Chinese restaurants were apparently associated with the migration business. So they just provide food, they create some money for their living. But Peking Cafe have a different goal. They want to attract, they want to integrate into the ultra audience, ultra customers, and also represent them as like the international dining space. And then come to 1930s, they established like the Nanking Cafe, Modern China Cafe, and Golden Dragon Cafe imagery further shaping the landscape of the Chinese dining in Australia. And the menu we find in the National Archive here still demonstrate the cafe still serves both Chinese and European cuisine. However, during World War II, the Chinese food became even more popular. And Chinese cafe, they changed to their established service simple compared to Peking cafe. The menu is come to more simple, quick, and popular Chinese food. However, the period after the World War II, so between 1947 and 1949, we saw some cafe workers facing deportation. They are forced to go back to their home country, underscoring the challenge of the conflict. Some Australian customers in Sydney and Melbourne petitioned to their local cafe in some case of deportation. They told the department, we want this chef, we want this worker stay in Australia. And according to an interview of the manager of the Golden Dragon Cafe, Chinese food was more popular than European cuisine during World War II, the end of World War II, and also the post-war period, because people want to try something different. And additionally, in 1955, we have the first Chinese cooking class in Sydney, and we was managed in a Chinese restaurant. And then from National Library's collection, I also find there was a Chinese Food Society was established by a group of Australian worker and businessmen. And also the other magazine show up. The cafe also will post the advertisement in a student's magazine to attract more students. And during this period, Asian students, some of them even worked at the cafe on weekend. The other very interesting thing I find from libraries' collection is this cafe benefit from the political competition between mainland China and Taiwan during this period. So if you were familiar with the Cold War history between Australia and Chinese relations, you will understand both Chinese governments, they tried to weapon the trade or the food to win the recognition from Australia. So we talk about, they will talk about the beef trade. But under that, I find the materials so interesting is because of that kind of competition. Now in Australia, we can have more cheaper tea from Taiwan and mainland China. And also, we have a more cheaper porn for Chinese cafe, and that is we need to credit to Arthur Galogen and his company, Wuhe, like the seafood distribution. So that allow the Chinese cafe can cook more porn for the Australia customers. And so this dynamic interplay between the geopolitical factor and business operation underscore the relationship between the politics and the dining landscape within the Chinese-Australian community. So the growing number of the Chinese cafe during this period can be attributed to the country's economy recovery and the increasingly popularity of the Chinese cuisine. And when this trade presents opportunity, it also brought up challenges. So now I'm going to talk about, on the other side, the story. Chinese workers from Hong Kong or mainland China during this period, who often lack the knowledge of the local law, and the face language barriers were exposed to exploitation by Chinese employees with the industry. So that means between 1950 to 1955, there was a secret contract between the Hong Kong agent and the Chinese cafe employer to bring more Chinese workers from mainland China and Hong Kong. And before they come, they even need to pay an entry fee to the agent and the employer, and they don't understand that is illegal. And they pay, and then when they arrive in Australia, they were forced to work longer hours and low wage. This exploitation underscores the darker side of the bomb of the Chinese cafe in Cold War Australia, highlighting the need for greater protection and support for immigrant workers in Australia. However, a scandal in 1953, a scandal involving the arrest and deportation of a 37-year-old Chinese worker, Ng Chang Bang. He had originally paid £500 in Hong Kong in 1952 to enter Australia, working at a Chinese market garden, where he claimed to have received no wage. So he moved to work in overseas Chinese cafe. This broke the contract, and he didn't understand. And then this made him in trouble when he was informed in 1953 that he would deport due to he leave the market garden to work in a Chinese cafe. This deportation was shocking for both Australian society and Chinese community. This deportation mentioned was indeed a key moment for Chinese community, recalling the memory of the 1949 deportation of the Chinese war refugee, which had an impact on the Chinese community in Australia. And if you listen to Professor Cam Lloyd's interview, he would indicate the horrid experiences of individuals who live in a constant fear of deportation. So back to that time, that was really a strong impact to the people, particularly the working class. And during this period, Australian newspaper, through fear of the communist China, and used that as the excuse to support the Hoxha policy, worsening the tension within the community. And then we have two associations established during this period. The New South Wales Chinese Workers Association was established in 1952. And to fight against that scandal, they begin to circle the pamphlet or, you know, the Chinese language public notice in Chinatown to service as a reminder to the Chinese labor, emphasizing the importance of unity and advocacy in the face of a potential deportation threat. So they use this case to remind the Chinese, if we don't work together, nobody knows who will be the next one to face the deportation. And then, according to the Chinese Worker Association, they state the Chinese worker under the sponsorship, under the contract, underwent the hostile constitution, they need to work over 70 hours per week, and for very, very little Australian wage. They were bound by restricted contract and denied freedom of the movement. So normally they would work 7 days a week, and they don't have the freedom of the movement to contact with other workers. And on the other hand, we also have the New South Wales Chinese Restaurant Employer Association established in 1953. And these two associations reflect the community's response to this challenge. Both organizations were performed with the principle of justice and friendship, aiming to protect their rights and interests of Chinese worker and restaurant owner alike. However, the formation of this association also highlights the dichotomy of the fears within the community. On one hand, they were concerned about the deportation under the Hoxha policy, which discriminated against a non-European immigrant. On the other hand, they were apprehensive about the spread of communism and its potential consequence for the Chinese community in local Australia. So this dichotomy with the Chinese community raised an important question about the underlying factor contributing to such division. Was it primarily driven by ideological conflict, such as the pro-communist China or the pro-free China? Or was it respond to discrimination policy and practice of the Hoxha policy? When there is no straightforward answer, delivery into a case study can provide insights into how Chinese cafe workers navigate and fight for their rights amid this challenge. So now I'm going to talk about a case after the deportation of that worker. The Chinese Worker Association worked very hard to make the worker to understand their right. And they need help, and the help is from the Australian Union. The cooperation between the Chinese Worker Association and the HCR, the Hotel, Club, and Restaurant Union, was effective in the case of modern China cafe, where four workers enduring long hours without proper reward. And that is a very, interesting is according to the recall from the Chinese Worker Association and the Chinese U League. A moment happened because one day this worker, they were outside a modern China cafe, and they just opposite a mandate position in 1953. And then one Chinese language leaflet from the Chinese Worker Association promoting them to seek support passed to these Chinese cafe workers. And they thought, oh, somehow we can seek support from this association. And this cooperation highlighted the importance of solidarity and collective action in advocating for the right and well-being of the Chinese cafe worker. So there are quite a few figures I want to highlight here. And this is Cliff Williams, which represents the Australian Union, along with Jack Yang. Jack Yang was an Australian-born Chinese, and he was an interpreter. And he was also appointed as a Chinese speaking organizer for the Australia Uni back to that time. Both of them were very active in advising the case. Their cooperation greater significant attention, leading to a settlement outside of the court, where the Chinese worker were given resident standards, and additionally, a more favorable contract from the Hong Kong agent were negotiated. So this victory was widely regarded as a significant win for the uni from both sides, promoting more Chinese workers to join Australia Uni. So here we have more people joining the uni. And so when they work together, they don't only fight against, you know, the illegal law, the unfair, unjust condition, but they also organize the social and cultural event to know each other. And this culture and social event strengthen the solidarity among workers. And in further support of the Australia workers, the Chinese Worker Association even established a kitchen for the unemployed servant in cooperation with the restaurant and the liquor trading employee union, demonstrating a commitment to the broader community welfare beyond their own membership. So this cooperative effort was a very good example of the power of solidarity and collective action in advocating for the workers' rights and well-being, regardless of the nationality or the background. And according to the Chinese U League and Chinese Worker Association, they believe that improved working conditions enable more workers to open their own restaurant later because they get more wages and more understanding about the law, and also the external social networking. When they join the union, they know more workers to work together for their future business. So this improvement in the working condition, along with other factors I explained earlier in my presentation, contribute to the growth in the number of the Chinese cafe during the 1950s. According to a recall from the Chinese Consul General, so that reports back to Taipei, he report roughly about 1,500 Chinese cafe during this period settled in Australia, indicating a significant increase in entrepreneurs' activity with the Chinese community. And the other case I want to highlight is the impact of the cultural and the social event, like the picnic, the dance. These were organized and invite the Chinese workers to come. They have a very interesting social impact. The example I want to show here is what I find is from the magazine from the HCR workers, which is housed in National Library. Show up Mary McKinney, who won the first mandate cream contest in Sydney in 1959. And she was born in 1942 and working at a golf club, and was selected for a young delegation from Australia to the World Youth Festival. So I think back to that time, she was only 17 years old, and that was a big thing for her. And how she won this contest is because her virtue in contest was attributed, according to the Worker magazine, the Uni's magazine, because he received the support from the Uni, which included Chinese and Aboriginal supporter. So Mary McKinney, who is with the Aboriginal and Irish heritage background. Upon her return, Mary participated in various social events hosted by the Chinese Worker Association and Chinese Youth League. Mary married to Peter Wong in 1962 and marked the beginning of the partnership deeply rooted in the community engagement. So Peter Wong actively involved in the Chinese Youth League and the Worker Association, and he met Mary through the social dancing of the uni. Together, they participate in various activities with the Chinese U League, including the screening of the Aboriginal movies, reflecting Peter's vocation for Aboriginal rights. Peter's commitment to the social justice is turned beyond his involvement in the Chinese community or Chinese workers' community. He sought financial support to send the other delegation to the other youth festival in 1962, aiming to raise awareness about the living condition of Australia Aboriginals on an international perform. This dissertation to advocating for mentoring a community underscore the intersectional approach Peter and Mary embrace in their activism, transcending boundary to support cause that aligned with their value of equality and justice. And we are very fortunate to have Peter's memory preserved in a book called South Floor Appeal, Trans Australia Voice, which just published in 2022, where he reflects on the impact of the Huajia policy on the trans community. He notes that even after the introduction of the new Migration Act in 1958, the barrier for the people of the Asian background still exist. Despite their effort toward the naturalization, it remains challenging for them to gain recognition as Australians. Peter's recollection shed light on the indigenous struggle faced by trans Australians during the Cold War period. His work serves as a moving reminder of the resilience it helps by individuals with the community. So through this different story and experience of the Chinese workers, I hope today we get a deeper understanding of the challenge they face and resilience they embody in the pursuit of justice in the Cold War Australia. Moreover, workers' stories have the potential to bridge a diverse and inspire unity among a diverse community. By highlighting a common struggle and a shared aspiration, this narrative and experience stories can foster connections and solidarity across different backgrounds and experience. I also hope that kind of story can help us to rethink the Chinese community during the Cold War Australia, rather than repeat a similar narrative talk about the division of the Chinese community. Give a very wrong label to say the poor China or poor few Taiwan. They can have their story reflect a more complicated life experience, and they deserve to have a further research and discovery. So come to my conclusion. So back to the beginning in my presentation, I want to understand how the Chinese community contribute to Cold War Australia, and I do want to argue, I argue Chinese cafe as a social issue for reshaping Australia's way of life in 1950s. So if we concern the Chinese student on Australia's campus play an important role to change Australia's perspective toward Asia or toward Asian immigration in the 1950s and 1960s, we should also recognize that the Chinese cafes and the workers' experience serve similar function. And today I also talk about the change of the Chinese cafe from nationalist idea to build an international space to a strategy perspective for a young immigrant during the Cold War period. We can see that the evaluation of the modern Chinese cafe in Cold War Australia reflects the social politics of everyday life, from negating social interaction to negating national identities, ideological conflict, and the right of the labor and citizenship. The goal of the cafe business isn't solely the result of the increased interest in Chinese cuisine, but also the result of the effort by both Chinese and Australian workers, or the, we can call unionists, to promote more equitable working condition in Australia. And also this empathy is turned beyond the Chinese-owned community to include other workers, including also as well as the Aboriginal Australian. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mei-fen. That was absolutely fascinating. And personally, thank you so much for putting a face and the stories to the records of individuals and, sorry, to the individuals represented in the records, in the historical record. Thank you. Okay, so we now have some time for some questions. As this presentation is being recorded, and for those of us with hearing problems, I'd ask you to wait for your question until the microphone can reach you. Do we have a question? One up the back.
Hi. This is a fun question for you, Mei. About the Chinese cafes, which Chinese staple dish is your favorite?
For Chinese customers?
Chinese customers or?
Well, for Australian customers as well.
I hope I can answer this question. But according to Arthur Gallagher's oral history, the prawn become a very popular dish because the Chinese cafe can provide a cheaper cost of the prawn dish. And also, I also come across with one documentary produced by ABC, but I don't have the right to show. And it also highlight the prawn be cooked in the Chinese cafe during the 1950s. I hope this answers your question.
Are you talking about honey king prawns?
I guess I can, if you go back to look at the, go back to look at the menu. I would not assume, you know, that kind of the dish is, they share something we're quite familiar today, like a spring roll. They begin to be very popular, you know, after the World War II. Yeah. Yeah, so if you're interested, I can pass through this menu to you for your interest.
Any other questions? One right at the back.
Thank you, Mei. Thanks very much for your presentation. Given the role of Australian unionists in assisting to improve conditions in Chinese cafes, at what time, or is there a time when you start to see the politics from mainland China reflected in the cafes? I'm presuming you've done most of your work on Sydney and Melbourne. And given that in the Australian trade union movement, there was also a division of allegiance in relation to the various political persuasions in mainland and Taiwan. So at what time does that become evident, or does it never become evident?
I can't really say in the 1950s we have the PRC's government involved in that kind of the struggle or campaign for the workers' right. However, during the between 1955 to until 1959, we do have the visitors from Hong Kong, China, and even Southeast Asia, and a particular interest on what is white ultra policy. However, I went through a couple of the report written by the Chinese authors back to, you know, I think one is from Malaysia and quite few from Hong Kong, and few reports from mainland China. They rarely talk about the right of the workers, but they did talk about, you know, organizing the union become a quite significant thing for the people in mainland China. And somehow it's also quite interesting to, this is not part of my research, but I also find that is also quite interesting to see the two China, they also compete on this area. They say, we care more about workers' rights. But also back to that time, we also need to understand, because before 1957, 58, the Chinese were not be allowed to naturalize to become Australia's subject. So that kind of the fear of the communism and also drive them to, you know, they are in between, and they also struggle to understand which kind of the right, you know, we really want to fight for. And I have to say this presentation was particularly focused on 1950s. And back to that time, we also have, you know, the scholar and some politician, they have that kind of privilege to visit China. But I did find a few MP who raised that kind of the issue about the Chinese cafe's workers' right in the parliament. But I didn't see a very serious debate or serious discussion between the government in a level. I hope I answer your question.
Further questions? Oh, and back again. thank you, Mei, for such an interesting presentation. Could I ask you if you could talk a little bit more about Taiwan becoming a popular holiday destination for Australians? That's something that, during that period, I was totally new to me, and I find that fascinating. I've never, ever heard anything about that. I think that's incredible.
Yeah, I also find this a fascinating story. And I just find the recall from the Taiwan's tourist department, and they do have the status of the foreign, the foreigners with Taiwan. And interesting is because I think it's in the late 1950s and early 1960s, the Taiwan also opened to the foreigners to visit. And then interesting is the Australian tourists that begin to like to visit Taiwan. And I don't know it's because the Frank Kuo's, you know, famous book about, he wrote about Taiwan in 1957 or 58. Maybe it's because of that kind of influence. But also back to that time, we also have the Australian businessmen travel through Asia, and Taiwan become a place they visit, and they also begin to have that kind of business. And also very important, I think, is because in the 1964, we have the Olympic Games in Tokyo, and back to that time, a lot of Australians, they visit Tokyo for the Olympic Games, and they also travel through Taiwan to Tokyo. And maybe that's also the other reason. And also very interesting is if you check that standards from Taiwanese government, it's interesting because the first one is Southeast Asia and America, North America. And these two areas, is they always have a lot overseas Chinese. So that makes sense. They, you know, they already naturalized to become American or other countries, and they visit Taiwan. But Australia seems a very, very different case. And I think it's in the mid-1960s or late-1960s, Australia become the top fifth tourist for Taiwan, yeah.
Thank you.
Any further questions? Thank you, Ray. Oh, yes. There's a microphone just coming.
Thank you. The Workers' Association was formed in 1952 and the Employers' Association in 1953. Is that just a coincidence, or was the Employers' Association in response to the workers getting mobilised, and what was their motivation?
I would say the case I say in 1953, that was the turning point for both sides to think we need to work together. We need to, you know, protect our rights and interest. Yeah. So the case I say in 1953, the scandal, and the scandal later, because of Australian media, it became a shocking example for the Australian society, and that really make the you know, community think we need to respond to this case, and that is why we have the. But the workers' association, they already investigated the problem before the scandal, so already know that there was the problem. So they set up the association quickly. And what happened is, you know, these Chinese cafe owners or employers, they also know what they are doing. But later they wait until the scandal happened, and they say, hey, we probably need our own association. But you can see today I don't have time to talk about how they mobilize each other to support each other. But you can see their social mobilization and their interest. You know, the thinking about citizenship, the right is very, very different. That's why I call, you know, social politics of everyday life. And yeah,
we have an online question. Did you look at the role of the Colombo Plan on shifting Australian attitudes to Asia in the 50s?
Colombo Plan, you mean the come to Australia? Mm. In fact, we do have a large number of private students. So they are not from a Colombo plan. They're from private student scheme. And particularly from the oral history project here in National Library, we also found this cohort, the private students cohort, they come from very diverse, and they will went to, you know, primary school, secondary school, college, and then maybe university. So they're quite different. But I didn't really have that kind of the story from the Colombo plan. But you know, the image I show, the student association in Victoria, they do have some students from Colombo plan from Southeast Asia. They also join this student club. And that is the other, I don't have time to talk about their activity, but that could be one example, the student from Colombo plan, how they contribute to this story. I hope I can have more details. Maybe I'll do the other presentation.
And another question from online. Did the Australian unions try to get Chinese restaurant workers to join the union?
Definitely. And with that case, they fight for the four workers in the modern China cafe. And they described that that was a big win, and I believe that was a big win, because after that, the Chinese worker believe it's effective if we work together. And they did join the Australian unions after that. And I think, I don't have the exact number, but it could be hundreds. Yeah. And I also wish to dig further about the recall of the uni to discover more stories. How the trans worker work for the uni.
And last question.
Hello. Forgive me for what might be a silly question, but I was wondering with the names of the cafes, the Canton, Peking, and Shanghai cafes, I noticed as well with the modern China cafe, there wasn't a Chinese sort of name that was immediately evident, but were there Chinese names for them that were different? I find that the names are very, as you said, sort of evoke these cosmopolitan or international, you know, the Peking Cafe, the Shanghai Cafe, but a lot of, and I'm not sure about this time, but a lot of Chinese migrants would have come perhaps from southern China. So was there a different name, and was that name, yeah, significant in another way?
The first cafe we have in Melbourne is called Canton Cafe, and I definitely refer to where they're from Canton. And then the one in Sydney is the Shanghai Cafe. And if some of you are familiar with the Trans-Australian history, you will know in the early 20th century, we do have a Trans-Australian migrant to Shanghai back to that time, so they use the Shanghai Cafe. And then we have a Peking Cafe. And that name, the Peking Cafe, is particularly referenced to Chinese Nationalist Party, Chinese Nationalism, because back to that time, the Republic of China's central government located in Peking, and so they use that. And we also have a Nanking Cafe. This is the other capital of the Republic of China. And we also have a Hong Kong Cafe. So maybe that is provide some, I don't know, geographical imagination of the Chinese immigrant in Australia. But interesting is during the World War II and after World War II, you will find the name of the Chinese cafe or restaurant is more diverse. And the other thing, why they choose the place, the Chinese place to name their cafe, maybe because they think Australian customers understand. What does that mean? So if they choose something else, maybe, yeah. And I have a full list of the cafe. And if you check the English name and the Chinese name, you also find that is quite interesting and very diverse. And they all, and also the Xie Tang's memoir also give the idea, you know, how they design, you know, which cafe's name they want to do. And everyone have different ideas. And then, yeah. But it's an interesting question. Thanks.
Okay, well, thank you all so much for your questions. Just before we let you go for the afternoon, just a few points of interest. We hope you can all join us for the next fellowship lecture, which will be Eleanor Whitcomb, Her Brilliant Career, which will be delivered by the 2023 National Library Fellow, Dr. Eleanor Hogan, and that's at 12:30 on Thursday, the 29th of February.
On the library's website, you can also find recordings of interesting and diverse recent talks and performances, such as the one today. And they're also available on the library's YouTube channel. So finally, I hope you will join me in thanking Dr. Mei-fen Kuo so much for her fascinating presentation, and also on a personal thanks for her contribution in preserving records of such importance in Australian cultural institutions, including the National Libraries. So please thank Dr. Kuo. Thank you very much. Have a good afternoon.